He spoke.
Can you hear me?
Father, forgive them. For they don't know what they do. Despite pain and agony, they wrote above his head, King of the Jews. This Easter day, we hail him not only King of the Jews, but King of Kings and Lord of Lords, conquering Lion of Judah, the beginning and the end. My hallelujah belongs to him.
My hallelujah.
for today from the Moravian textbook in your own personal time. Let us pray. Truly indeed, God, all our hallelujahs belong to you, because you are our Father, our King, and you, Lord, possess us and have all of us in your being and in your hands. You rose from the grave, O Lord, showing us that you are God and that through you all things are possible. So today, Lord, we lift your name on high and we praise you from the depths of our hearts because you deserve all our praise and glory. We invite you, Lord, in this Easter worship. We invite you to sit with us at home, Lord, as we worship you through spirit and in truth. So we invoke and invite your Holy Spirit among us, O God, through your Son, Jesus the Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us stand together for the hymn, Jesus Christ is risen.
Jesus Christ is risen.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. We invite you to share
A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believing." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Last verse. Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Word of the Lord.
Blessed are those that have not seen, but yet they believe. Young Samuel said, "Speak, Lord, thy servant heareth." Reverend Ockery Brown will bring the word as a servant of our God. But we must prepare our hearts. And in doing so, we ask that we stand there. Let's worship God. Let's worship God in dance. Let's worship God in song. Let's worship God in music. Let's stand. Oh, my soul doth magnify the Lord.
Oh, my soul doth magnify the Lord. Thank you.
and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. John. The Gospel of John opens up for us the history of Jesus' beginning, Jesus' mission, and Jesus' function while he is on earth. The writer John described Jesus as the physical God, or the physical Word of God, who is now extending grace and truth to all of us, who is now restoring the law of Moses, or the law given to Moses in a different way, and is now expressing God to the world and to us as well. If you should read St. John chapter 1, verse 18, you will hear John saying these words: "No one has ever seen God but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in the closest relationship with the Father, God Almighty." We are so tied up with the thought that Thomas really saw and believed. We are tied up with that thought. However, while he was in the upper room, Thomas, that is, few days after Easter, he cried out in a loud voice and said, "My Lord and my God." I want us to understand that while Thomas was in the upper room experience, when Jesus presented himself to them, that Thomas did not see God the Father standing before him, but what Thomas saw was Jesus in the flesh. So as we study this passage together, I want us to understand, as we read into it, I want us to hear as well the invitation that Jesus is extending to Thomas to come and to be active in faith, and to move on from what he can see to the divine reality that brings greater truths before him. And indeed, brothers and sisters, at the end of the story, as Jesus and Thomas had this encounter, it was no longer possible for Thomas to continue to doubt Jesus, or to doubt that Jesus, this Jesus, his beloved Master, who had been crucified and buried, was now alive. But as he encountered Jesus in this upper room experience, Jesus encouraged Thomas to obtain, which he did take, to obtain this faith, to come and believe and to accept the reality that he, Jesus, is alive and well. So what Thomas had to do, or what Jesus had to say to Thomas to get into that place, in reaching that place, Thomas had to know, validate through the concluding confidence that to witness Jesus is the same as seeing God the Father as well. So Thomas had to believe that inside of Jesus, or within Jesus, God the Father is exclusively and completely discovered, since Jesus himself is one with God the Father as well. So I want us to notice this character, Thomas. And I don't want you to miss anything about him. I want you to pay keen attention to his movements and his behavior. Notice his words after seeing that Jesus was alive. Notice his words. Notice what he said. My Lord and my God. These words, my friends, were not echoed out of flattery for Thomas's sake, but he heralds them out of deep respect, out of deep recognition, out of deep praise to the risen Lord who was in his midst. And I want to pause to make a comment right here to us, to those who are listening. And this is the comment. Worship, brothers and sisters, is not about us. It's never about us. But worship is all about God Almighty. So notice his words. Notice that Thomas's words brought worship to Christ from his heart. Notice that his words brought clear indication that his God, his friend, is alive and well, and is standing right there before him. So as he speaks the words, my Lord and my God, he speaks on behalf of the church, us, and those who will one day join the company of Christ as well. My Lord and my God. As we look at his character and what he did, you will agree with me, brothers and sisters, that furthermore, this amazing, courageous expression of confidence is so outstanding from Thomas, my Lord and my God. It is so outstanding. Why is it outstanding? Remember that earlier Thomas had persistently refused to believe that Jesus Christ was risen. And at this present moment in the story, Thomas is now admitting that Jesus, in his beauty and holiness, in his authority, is standing before him, inviting him to an act of faith. And this act of faith is one of the spiritual marks of the Christian journey. And by doing this, by coming to a faith in action, by doing this, he now joins with us as one who believes and calls for those who have not yet believed to come and do likewise. My question is to us this Easter Sunday, are you moving and acting in faith? So when we move into this faith that Jesus invited Thomas to come and be a part of, when we move and act in this faith, we receive an extra blessing. And this extra blessing we receive is Christ himself. Why? Simply because we believe yet without direct view of the risen Lord. None of us who are listening did not experience the risen Lord. But we believe that Jesus was risen. And why do we believe that? Because of the act of faith that we have come to accept and be a part of. I want to ask you this question as you listen to me. And this is the question. Is it easy to believe in something that is detailed to you, even if you have not received the credible? Let me ask the question again. Is it easy to believe in something that is detailed to you, even if you have no way of checking the credibility of the story? Yes, you can. You can, through showing trust in the history of the eyewitness or the messenger. So notice what Thomas did and the disciples. Thomas and the disciples and us as well can come to the great conviction in that Jesus is completely trustworthy as a messenger sent from God. And all that he has said about God and about himself is factual. And that God's word is the ultimate wholesome fact we all need to believe and use for our lives' progress. So we have to believe in the words of Jesus Christ for us to see what God in Jesus Christ is doing. So as we celebrate this resurrection today, this resurrection story about Jesus from the dead is the clear display of truth found in the Word of God, expressed by Jesus and being acted out by us. In truth, in confidence that Jesus has risen. And brothers and sisters, this is the truth which we believe, and this is the concluding seal of the divine evidence of Jesus' entire mission. That he came to earth, so to die, to give man, humanity, new life and new perspective towards heaven. So in the reality of all of this, the faith of the disciples was recognized on a base that nobody could ever or should damage. And this as well is the faith they have given to us to carry on. And we need to express this kind of faith that truly indeed we believe in what Jesus did for all of us. If you have the chance, and if you should ever read 1 John chapter 1, verse 1, you will hear John saying these words: that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, and looked upon, and touched with our hands, the word of life, this we declare to you. So the faith we have today is rest upon the testimony of the disciples. Notice what Jesus told them in John chapter 20, verse 21. As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you as well. So then, brothers and sisters, faith comes through witnessing. It starts with Jesus bearing witness to his Father. Then the disciples witness to Jesus. However, for us to accept what they have passed on to us, a different witness and one more testimony is necessary. And that witness for us is found in the form of the Holy Spirit. So for us then, it is through the Holy Spirit, it is through the Holy Spirit that Thomas was able to be transferred from seeing Jesus as a human to the Lord and God he is. And through this same Spirit, this same Holy Spirit, we are drawn to walk forward in faith as well. So what John chapter 20 is doing for us is this. It calls us to consider how we are able to trust in Jesus Christ with full declaration, with full certainty, even though we have not plainly seen him or owned him after his resurrection. So this Easter Sunday, God needs us to rest our faith on his testimony, on the disciples' testimony, which gives us clear evidence of his resurrection. So as we bring forward our faith to believe in the testimony of Christ, this faith also brings to our knowledge that true faith leads to conversion as well. That true faith leads to self-emptying. That true faith leads to self-surrender. And that true faith leads to self-examination. So we know our faith in Christ, it will be very difficult for us to do these things of self-examination, self-emptying, self-surrender, and conversion as well. We have to believe inside of what Christ has presented to us after resurrection. So one of the many requirements from God to us is faith. Why? Because what he wants to give to us is supposed to be accepted on our path without seeking high, illustrious knowledge before we believe or accept what he has to say. That is part of our problem. And that is part of the problem that the church is struggling with today. Before persons can fully come to Christ, they have to receive some high-level language to explain the mystery of Christ and the resurrection of Christ and how Christ's resurrection was possible before they can come and accept and express words like my Lord and my God. So the faith that we possess today, and the faith that Jesus is calling you to, is found in him, is found in his death and resurrection as well. And furthermore, this faith that Jesus is calling us to develop is found, or will help us to receive God's self-revelation through Jesus Christ. Jesus is saying, if our faith is developed, if our faith is built on him, on his resurrection, then it helps us to receive God's self-revelation. self-revelation and God self-communication as well. Why? Because it is inside of Christ. It is inside of Christ that God reveals himself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the Trinity. And it is through Jesus we are now invited to share or to participate in God's divine life. That was what Jesus was saying to Thomas. It was the same kind of a thing that Jesus was saying to Thomas. And when Thomas recognized that Jesus was saying that to him, listen to his words again. My Lord and my God. I want to stop. Let me go back again and say this. That when Thomas said, my Lord and my God, that this statement came out of the act of recognition. It came out of praise and deep respect for God. And I'm saying to us this morning that those words from Thomas should be our anthem throughout the church every day and in our own lives as we strive to live as true and faithful witnesses for Jesus in a world that has lost most of its way towards Christ. If you should think, brothers and sisters, if you should think deeply with me, if you should think deeply with me, you will notice that these words from Thomas are also and should be expressed when we participate in the Holy Communion as well. Simply because Jesus has once again presented himself at the table, feeding us, giving us himself in the form of symbols, bread, wine, and grape juice, and offering us his peace and his gift of forgiveness. So throughout the Holy Communion, all that Jesus comes to give us is laid out for us, and we should accept all of what Jesus Christ laid out for us at the Holy Communion table, faith and not by sight. When I was at university, I had a batchmate who is an Anglican. And forgive me for those who are Anglican, will be listening, but he's an Anglican, and a very good friend. And he often said that while you're at university, you can walk by faith. You have to walk by sight and then faith afterwards, because sometimes these lectures are so unpredictable. But what Jesus is calling us to do is to first express faith and then believe, and then out of deep respect worship him from our hearts, just as what Thomas did. Just as what Thomas saw, we need to see God in Jesus Christ. God who is risen from the dead, who is with us in the form of the Holy Spirit, and who presents himself to us at the Holy Communion table as well. All the respect, out of worship, out of recognition that his heart was open up to full and wholesome praise. But as I close, I wonder, can we, brothers and sisters, can we be like Thomas? Can we be receptive like Thomas today? In instead of doubtful Thomas? Can we believe out of faith and worship God without first seeing Him in the flesh standing before us? One of the problems we face as a society and as a church is this. And Jesus said it in John as well. And this is what Jesus said, which is our problem. Unless we see signs and wonders, we will not believe. And most of us, most persons, before they can accept Christ who presents himself to us after his resurrection, they are looking for signs and wonders before they can come and believe in God. But let me say this to us, that for us, it begins on the faith, the word, and the acceptance of Christ in our lives. And when we have gone through all of that now, the evidence of signs and wonders will be presented to us as we worship God. So it's not the other way around. It's not first seeing signs and wonders before we come. But we come first in faith, accepting Christ, living a life for Christ, and the evidence of signs and wonders will present themselves. Thomas, earlier in the story, as you heard and as you read, did not believe when his friends and brothers, the rest of the disciples, told him that Jesus was alive. He did not believe. When Jesus presented himself to him, he said, "My Lord and my God." In other words, "Lord, I now believe that you have been risen from the dead." Can you believe like Thomas this morning on this Easter Sunday? Yes, we can. It starts with an act of faith. That's where it begins. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we are grateful to you that you are our Lord and God, and that you have presented yourself to us at the Holy Communion table. You have presented yourself to us at our homes. You have presented yourself to us anywhere we are. And out of deep respect and recognition, we worship you today. So all the hallelujahs, Lord, belong to you because of this great reality of the resurrection. And we thank you for your word from heaven through your Son, Jesus the Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you for your blessing.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.